Hi, I'm Adam Hergenrother, and welcome to Business Meets Spirituality. This is a show for leaders and high achievers who've experienced success on the outside and still feel like something is missing in their life, who have made money and accomplished big goals, but then ask themselves, is this all there is? After all, business is nothing but a conduit for your personal growth. Need nothing and enjoy everything. This is Business Meets Spirituality.
A couple of days ago, we were on a prep call for a speaking engagement that Adam and you and I are going to be doing in Las Vegas in about a month. And the host of the event, I thought, said something kind of interesting. He said, Adam, you are known as the time guy. You are a master of time. And then he asked, you know, how did that happen? Did you always have control over your calendar? Or when was there a shift for you when you really got purposeful with your time?
Yeah, it's a great question. Well, time is an illusion in itself, right? And we'll kind of talk about that. But if you bring it back to my when I first started in business, even before you were on board, it was mid 2006. I had no control of my time. I mean, the reality was when I first got into business, I got into it to make a ton of money, right? And we've talked about that before. And the funny thing is I would sleep in till like 7:30, 8:15. I was kind of just that, and I would get up and within 5 or 6 minutes or 11 minutes, I was like out the door or working or trying to do something like that. There was no like leisure time to work on myself beforehand. So I would literally just kind of sleep in late. And then I would just work. There was no boundaries. I didn't have kids then. I wasn't married then. So there was just no boundaries. I just worked nonstop. And for me, that... it's funny because this is a conversation about time and work, right? There was no like punch in at 8 then punch out at 5. It was just things had to get done. It was a results driven organization, and the organization was Adam, right? But it was just results for me. And so I just didn't think about time in the same context as like we're showing up at 8 and we're jumping out at 5 and then the day stops. It was just, I would work 12, 13, 14, 15 hour days. It just didn't matter, right? It was just, I was building it. I was growing. I was learning a lot, right? Then over time, right, you started to realize that, A, I've started adding more leverage in there. I started understanding that you can use your money to invest to gain time. That's kind of what people get into organizations for, or particularly if you're looking from my standpoint, if you're a visionary and founder and taking all of this risk and you start putting back into people, you essentially want freedom. You want time for those things to come in. And then, you know, I started getting bigger into having a morning routine, right? And the entire morning routine kind of triggered, and I wanted, and I started feeling the benefits of having this morning routine. So that kind of got me purposeful on having a very purposeful timed morning routine. In the beginning, it was mostly just maybe call it like 20 minutes, 30 minutes of actual personal development time. I mean, to what it is today, which is hours long. So I kind of just started that process for it. And then again, I would kind of just keep slithering it away. It was like 6 and then 5:15. And this took like a year, 18 months to kind of continue to go down to find that moment. There was a period where I got to, you know, kind of fast forward a lot, where I was getting up at 3 o'clock every day. And that was honestly just too early. Like some days I'll do that if I have a long exercise day, but most days, like for me, the magic point is 4 o'clock. If I can get up at 4, that's typically a really good point. So I try to structure my day from there. But really where, so then I just started, I think it's just sequential, right? This kind of process of really getting focused on time starts to become really, really important. And I'm gonna bring some tactics in that you can bring into your business for time, but I'm just kind of sharing a little bit of the story. Really where I got extremely purposeful, it's particularly talking about it in a business structured time, is when a little over three years ago, where I realized I wanted to sign up for Ironmans. And I jumped in wholeheartedly with doing Ironmans. And so then this whole new slew of training took on. And, you know, I kind of have this quality that I, when I take on something, it's not really to take on to like be the best at it, to be the best at it. I take it on to see how much I can extract from what I'm doing and how much I can learn from it, and how much I can grow from it. And so I just kind of throw myself all into it. And I've done that through a lot of things in my life. It's just throwing myself to just extract everything that I can from this new process, this new journey, this new growth that I'm having. And so I did that with Ironmans. And so I hired a really high professional coach, and all of a sudden I went from like exercising maybe like 6 hours a week to like 16. And I remember when I first started doing these weeks on Fridays, I would typically, you need in an Ironman training session, you need two big days throughout the week. And the big days are somewhere between, you know, 4.5 and 6.5 hours one day, and then somewhere between 4.5 and 5.5 hours the next day of actual exercise, not like prep time on driving, actual exercise. So I didn't want to take away from my family time on the weekend. So I said, man, I'm not going to exercise for 6 hours on Saturday, then 5 hours on Sunday. Like I'm putting my family in too much pressure for having them to bend to my schedule. And I didn't like that. So then I started emailing, I think I started with my calendar, and it was basically like, I'm just going to take Friday off. I'm going to go ahead and just, I started emailing Amy, I think it was, and just said, hey, you know what? Just cancel my appointments on Friday, right? Cancel my appointments on Friday. I did this for like 3 weeks. And then all of a sudden, I don't know if it was you or Amy. I forget who it was. It was you. Yeah. And then I think you emailed me back and you said, well, why don't I just from now on, just not have Friday as a day that you are accountable to anybody. And I said, well, that's a great idea. But then it was kind of this fear, a couple things went through, like fear of like, am I going to have to justify my work to people because there is like, now I'm working this 4 day work week? Or, and then this other thing was like, can I get everything done in 4 days, right? And so I, because that's why Friday is a long day. So I went to this kind of 4 day structure. And what I found was hopefully something that you can take away. Well, I actually got so much more purposeful with the moments that I was willing to work. And I think the key word is there that you're willing to work. Now, obviously, we have a large organization. I have lots of employees that I can help from doing these things. But there's some things and some tactics that anybody can employ when you do this. For number one, what I found was about 50% of what I was doing in a week didn't matter. About 50% of actually the appointments, anything that I was in, just didn't really matter. Now, I'm not saying it wasn't active. It just didn't really matter. So I think one of the things that you can do...
I was going to say they did matter, but it didn't necessarily mean that you needed to be involved in them.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah. Or I didn't need to be involved in them, or it wasn't the highest and best use of everyone's time to actually have that meeting, right? And so you kind of look at those things. And Hallie and I sat down and said, okay, and we continue to do this just about every quarter, and we reassess my calendar. We reassess like anybody else that we're pulling into these meetings to make sure that they're being impactful, so we're not wasting anybody else's time. So I would suggest that you go out there and cut, just for a week, just try this, right? Or cut your appointments in half, right? Because here's the thing. There is the Parkinson's law, right? Which is basically, if you actually look at the definition, if you will, of Parkinson's law, which is work expands so as to fill the time available for its completion.
Which is what you did with your four-day work week.
Exactly. And so what I find is like with meetings, it's the same thing here. It's like, by the way, where did like a 30-minute meeting come from? Like, how did that duration show up? Like, it just... all of a sudden, somehow, like you say, hey, in 5 seconds, you realize you need to meet with Hallie. And then you said, oh, great, I need 30 minutes. Really? Because you took the time to like sketch out this conversation to realize it needs 30 minutes. No, we don't. We just naturally go to a 30-minute block, right? And so what I found is people show up a little bit late, or at least I do. And then because nothing really starts on time and people are doing this. And then you kind of get into a heart of a conversation. And then you look down, you realize you still have like 11 minutes left in there. So you find something else that you can talk about that seems relevant to the conversation. And then magically at 29 minutes into the conversation, right, you find a spot where you can just then stop and everyone gets up and leaves, right? And versus approaching this as like, hey, I need 3 minutes. Right? I need a 5-minute conversation to get right to the heart of it and you can solve these things. So go back and eliminate 50% of your time allotment for meetings. So an hour to 30 minutes, 30 minutes to 15. And also go through and just eliminate any meetings that you just don't necessarily need. And if you're not in control of being able to eliminate necessarily like I can, just sit down with somebody and help them out and go ask, like, do I really need to be in this? What is the purpose of this meeting, right? I love how Elon Musk talks about meetings in general and just his overall his thinking around meetings is that most of them are just, he thinks like 90% of them are just useful or are not useful at all, especially if it can be solved in an email that people can do it at their own time, kind of like on demand, different things that are there. So, I mean, Hallie, you've been involved with kind of shaping this calendar for a while in time. What have you seen?
Well, of course, the most immediate question that comes to mind is how do we apply all of those things that you are just talking about to, which is really visionary and founder and, you know, business owner specific to an employee?
Yeah.
Are there differences?
Well, I think there are, right? I mean, clearly when you're in control of like, you know, like it's good and bad, right? Like it's good because you're in control of things, but at the same time, you're also in control of everything. So you have to be responsible for everything as well too. And so for me, it was obviously easier. I didn't really have anybody to to account for. And so the other thing about this is that when you think about a 4-day work week, yes, you can say that you've earned the right to do this and you don't need to justify why you work 4 hours, four days a week. I'm just sharing with you like what I've done to be able to really compress my time to make sure that I'm in the most impactful meetings, then I'm working on the most important things I need to do. And I'll give you a couple of tactics today to do that. But also the other thing that we were having this conversation about this before we jumped on here, is on Fridays, it's not like I'm lying around watching, you know, Oprah, right? Oprah's great, but like, it's not like I'm just lying around doing that. I am exercising for 4 or 5 days. And I know some people go, wow, that's not really work. I get it. But sitting on a bike for 4 or 5 or 6 hours and running is harder than work for me, right? I also read an entire book basically, or listen to like 7 podcasts on Friday. So I'm increasing this massive input. Now, I know there's this discussion about it, that is that work, right? And we're kind of thinking about what's the definition of work, and that's
well for a business owner, there comes a time in yes. there, or a CEO within a large organization, there comes a time when what you are just talking about is the work. Now, it's not going to necessarily be the case for 90% of the population, because 90% of the population aren't necessarily, you know, the owner of the company like me, right? Yes. I mean, I have a lot of control. Mm-hmm. I don't have total control over everything. Wish I did, but I don't. But that is your job, and that does become your work. That wouldn't necessarily be my work, but that's also not what you hired me to do.
Yeah, you know, one of my major mentors in my business career basically came to me at one point in time, well, still working 7 days a week, right? And said, hey, Adam, understand, at some point in your life, your work, your job is going to be to read a book a day. Like, you're just going to have to do it. It's kind of like Warren Buffett, you know, everyone knows about that. Like, he reads mm-hmm. 8 hours a day, or Mark Zuckerberg, how many books he reads. Because your goal is to stay ahead and lead your team. And the only way you stay ahead and lead your team is to have more input.
And now I will say, I know that a lot of people listening to this podcast are entrepreneurs yes. or very entrepreneurial. And while it might not be this four-day week, it is crucial that they are finding time, carving out time, maximizing their time so that they do have certain hours for personal development activities, whether that's exercise, reading, journaling, etc.
We were doing a live podcast the other day, or a teaching, and you said about work on Fridays. You said, what was the wording that you used? Because I thought that was really good.
Yeah, you're simply just not accountable to anybody else for your time Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
Yes.
Doesn't mean that you're not doing things. You're emailing, you're coming up with creative ideas, you're reading articles and listening to podcasts, but you're not accountable to the organization, to me, to anybody else in internally in the company or externally, other business partners. Yeah. You are totally unaccountable for your time while you're working. And in fact, that's actually how I enjoy spending the weekends as well. Yes. I am not accountable to anybody for my time. Very often I'm also working.
Yes. Yeah. And I think that's a good way of saying it. It's not that you're kind of not working, but you're working on your input the entire time. And then Monday through Thursday, I'm very accountable to my calendar, right? It's just, it's fixed. It's there, not fixed, but it's just the dates are set, and there's very few moments.
Accountable to our leaders and our
employees, to everybody, to the community, to the people that are clients, everyone we're serving, very, very accountable. And then that Friday, Saturday, Sunday is that kind of gaining clarity, right? What went right with the week? I do a lot of journaling during this time. I do a lot of reflection. I also do a lot of planning and thinking just in my journaling and my process, so that I can come on a Monday and then re-energize or reset the tone or figure out what conversations I have to have. So I think it's instrumental to be able to have some sort of time built into your calendar to be able to do that effectively, so you can gain that clarity. And that goes for employees too. I'm not saying that you need to necessarily take a day, but as you're doing these things, you can really find some time. So how do you find some more time? We talked about cutting the meetings in half. The other thing that you can do is start measuring your day in minutes. This has been instrumental for me. A lot of people see time in terms of days, weeks, or months, or even a year. Like, I can't wait to get through this month. Can't wait to get to this year. And they kind of just lump time into this overarching large duration of time. Instead of really coming down and going, okay, I've got, what am I going to do for the next minute? What for about the next 5 minutes? Like, you start measuring your day. What did I just do for the last 10 minutes of my day? Right. And for me, even this morning, I was here, I was coming in, and I got in, and I knew I had to prepare for some of these things. And I started replying to some emails, which, again, I didn't really necessarily need to do at this moment, right? And then I asked myself, I said, man, how am I measuring my time right now? Literally, the question went through, and I said, this is not the best use of my time. So I put my email away and went back to preparing.
You were being busy.
Yes, I was being
busy.
And I just asked, I said, what did I just do the last 4 minutes of my time? I'm like, I mean, I allowed myself to get distracted in email. And so I said, I turned that off, put classical music on, and I went back to what I was starting to do before I got distracted, which was preparing and taking notes and figuring out what I wanted to talk about and kind of the whole what we're doing here, right? And so it was just a prime example of that, of just what the difference you can do each moment.
Why do you think so? I mean, there's so many people who want to accomplish great things and have things in life and, you know, discover themselves and make an impact on the world. Why are so many people procrastinating or distracting themselves? Like you were just talking about, what is driving them to do that instead of doing what they actually want to do?
Yeah. So there's two ways to answer this, but the first one is what's driving them to do that is the fact that they don't really know what they want. It's the lack of actually having clarity around what it is that you want out of your life and different things. For instance, you don't know what, and the second part of this is you don't know what to say yes to and what to say no to, because you're not very clear on what it is that drives you or what you have to say yes to. There's not like a course that people take this as a decision-making 101.
So how do you get clear?
Yeah, so what you have to do is you have to, I love this phrase, people that matter the most matter more than anything else. Therefore, your decisions become easy. Let me dissect that for a second. But people that matter the most matter more than anything else. Therefore, my decisions become easy. What that's saying is that your employees, like people, doesn't mean it can be your family, it can be your people, it can be your leaders, it can be the people that are in your room, it can be your clients. The people that matter the most matter more than anything else. Therefore, your decisions on what you need to do in that moment should become easy. As long as you're clear on what matters most what you're doing in this moment. So if you're here and I'm like, okay, what matters most is my attention to be on this podcast, right? Or if it's my, you know, if I'm in a meeting with my CFO, the most important thing that I can be doing this is being present and giving him my attention in this moment, because I know that this is the most important thing for both of us to be doing.
Can we zoom out
Yes.
of that for a little bit? Totally makes sense in the moment, but how do you know this podcast or that conversation with the CFO was the most important thing to be spending your time on?
Well, thanks for bringing this full circle, because that's why having that Friday, Saturday, and Sunday to gain the clarity, to stop and realize what is the most important thing that you can see, instead of just being so wrapped up in your job and being able to look at the larger vision, which again, you asked me personally, so my job is to make sure I'm casting that vision, is to make sure that we're going in the right direction, right? And as an employee, you need to wake up and ask yourself, what's the most important thing that I can do based on the vision? And if you don't know what the vision is or the numbers you need to go after, or what's the most important thing that you want to go after to do in that moment, then you should get clarity from whoever's leading you, right?
Or just the vision on your life in general, right? I mean, that dictates what job you take, what company you're with. So how do you recommend people get clear on that? It's not just about the company. It's
I was looking at it from a business perspective,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, we swapped roles there for a second. Right. Yeah.
And so if you look at it from a life perspective, I mean, we use a tool called the Future Self, right? And people can find that or just email us and we can send that out to you. But I think it's actually on the website.
Yeah.
It's adamhergenrother.com. You can find the Future Self on there, and that breaks it down into six different categories. And it starts to get you very clear on where and what you want to accomplish in these six different categories, right?
And then those decisions start
becoming
easier.
Exactly. And so but most people will never stop to find out what it is that they want clarity on, right? It's like, most people are taking other people's answers because there's safety in other people's answers. And so instead of deciding what it is that you want for yourself, right? You literally are digesting, right? Other people's answers because there's safety in there instead of trying to figure out your own. And so if you hear this, I always kind of wonder this, why don't people stop and kind of gain this clarity and really move forward with this? Like, why aren't they? And I think a lot of it has to do with they almost don't want to find the truth, right? They almost don't want to be in a situation where they're forcing themselves to ask what matters most. Because you know why? This is kind of like when you know what matters most, you know what has to be done. And I don't think a lot of people want to change. Right. I think, like, if you're listening to this, obviously you're wanting to change, you want to grow. So it's hard for you to understand that. But I can remember at parts of my life where early on in my childhood, like, it wasn't easy for me to change, to do any of these things like it is now. And I think a lot of people just have no, you know, comprehension that they need to change or want to change. And so they're just comfortable taking other people's answers. And so not having to search for the clarity that makes their decisions easy. And so it's like there's always one component that they're saying yes to that drives so much into their business. And so when you learn this, and think about this from a practical example in your life, the day before you go on vacation, or even the week before you go on vacation, you all of a sudden get like this this, you're so good at saying no, aren't you? It's like you get so much, people are always like, I got so much done during that week. Well, why? You got so much done because you literally had like this badge to kind of be a jerk, right? To kind of be like, no, you're not really being a jerk, but you kind of had this new ability to say no to everybody else, but you had a valid excuse that you felt was a valid excuse to be able to tell people.
It's a socially acceptable
excuse to say no, so that you could then say yes to the better things because you had a time for vacation, right?
And even in treating every week like you're going on vacation is, again, Parkinson's law.
Yes.
In action.
Yes.
Which is why people get so much done.
Yes, it is. And so 24 hours, we all have 24 hours in a day. So we know that time is not the cheat. It can't be. Nobody's invented more time yet, right? It'd be cool if they did, but they haven't. And so that it's not, people like to think that people are more successful for other reasons. People are mostly successful for the reasons for how they use their time. You know, one of my mentors always shared with me that, like, if you take out your calendar, not the pretty 6 different color category calendar that you've created for yourself, the actual calendar that you have is generally a reflection of, you know, your income or what your life looks like, right? Like whether you went to the gym, if it's on your calendar, or whether you didn't, right? Like the meals, the date nights that you had with your partner, right?
It shows what's actually important
to you. Exactly, right?
And not what you tell yourself or tell others that's important to you.
Yeah. And one of the things he just reminded me of is when you ask people like, hey, do you have kids in the room? And people say, yes, I have kids. And I say, you know, would they be the most important thing to you? And of course, everyone would say, yes, they are. And then you follow up that question was, well, give me your bank account and your calendar, and I'll tell you whether or not that's actually true. Right. And it's not like there's not a judgment there. You're not doing it consciously. Just most of how people spend their time and spend their money isn't a direct reflection for what that is. That's why when people that matter the most matter more than anything else, then decisions become easy. An example of that would be how you invest your money. Right. And so how you can save money and buy different things so you can get freedom to spend more time with different things, or how you structure your day and all these different things. So people don't stop to reflect on having clarity in their life about where they want to go, on the kind of, again, go to the future self, revisit that, write that out, and then start. We actually did a whole podcast on it. You can go back and listen to that future self podcast about gaining clarity on time. Look, time is this illusion. And the reason why time is an illusion, because all you have is time. And I'm not saying you do this, but if you literally just went out there and just said, I'm going to give up my responsibilities as a parent, my responsibilities as a work or as an owner, or as an employee, and I'm just going to lay on a beach. You have the option to do that, right? I'm not saying you can.
I just feel like that's such an interesting dichotomy, because all we have is time, and yet our time here on earth is so limited.
Yes.
So we're always constantly playing with this, almost like fighting with ourselves about, we have all sorts of time. We're going to, you know, that's all we've got. It doesn't matter, you know, what you just said versus, but we only have 80 years here. So what are we going to do?
What are we going to do with
our time?
Yeah, it's finite.
So we're fighting against ourselves constantly.
Yeah, your finite period here, in the context of each day, you have 24 hours. So you can do anything you want. People, because the reason I guess I go with that conversation is people always come to us and say, I just don't have time. I don't have time to do this. It's not true. Mm-hmm. That's what I mean by that. It's actually not true. You could let go of a whole bunch of other things. I'm not saying you should. I understand you got responsibilities. My whole point is that you need to say, I'm choosing to spend my time on something different. Because then you start gaining control of time versus this illusion that I don't have time. Right? And that's where people get lost, is I just don't have time. Well, stop. Stop that. That's actually all you have is time. It's all it is. It's just going by. It's like, you know, I think of this when I go back, I always think of this analogy as like this river that's flowing. And when you're born, right, the earth peoples, like apple trees, apple, right? Like you just earth, that's a whole other spiritual conversation we'll get into. But anyways, you kind of just drop into this boat in this river the whole point of me saying that was that, like, when you're born, you get put into this, Hallie's looking at me weird. Like when you get born, you get into this river of this canoe, and the canoe is all of a sudden going downhill. So meaning that, like, the minute you come into this earth, this physical form.
Life is moving,
right? And it's kind of, you get into this boat, and then obviously when you have the ability to start making your own decisions, you have all these intersections. Like picture it, like every 200 yards, there's another intersection, right? And so you get to make a decision. And if you're just accepting other people's answers and adjusting them, then you're not making your own decisions. You're making somebody else's decisions for your life. And so you just, oh, I'm going that way. And just every time, every 200 yards, every 15 seconds, there's another decision, you're just going there. So if you don't know where you're going, you don't have the clarity on this, that's why it's the most important thing, is understanding what your true north is, right? Understanding what each aspect means to you, right? So that when you come to each decision point, because here's the thing you can't avoid. You can't avoid not making decisions. Well, I guess you can avoid them. You're just allowing somebody else to make the decision for
you. Not making a decision is in fact actually a decision.
Yes. Thank you, Allie. That's very insightful.
It's a self-sabotaging behavior to a certain degree.
Yeah.
The not making decision, procrastination, distracting yourself. Why are people doing that?
Because they don't know what's important.
They don't know what's important or where they're
going.
That's
what it comes down to, right? Yeah. And so that's why when you can think about you're in this river and it's just the world is constantly expanding and you're just floating on this river until you leave this earth, right? And you're faced with these decisions each moment. And so unless you know how, that's why I'm saying decisions actually become very easy when you know what's important. So meaning like, you know, a practical example from a family life, like I have 3 kids under 7, right? I mean, I have 17 different birthday parties every weekend that we get invited to. It's okay to say no to those things, right? It's your child will be fine, I promise, right? Like, and so you can go, yes, you can go to one or them if you want, but if it's going to take your entire family and ruin the whole day, I mean, ruin, that's not really the right word, but just use the time in a different place. You couldn't do that because you like to go skiing. Skiing for us as on a family on a Saturday of being all together is more important than that birthday party. There are two decisions you get to make, but if you don't know what's more important, then you'll get caught in this limbo and then you'll go, well, I don't really know. And this is why people say yes to things they know they're going to be saying no to later on.
You always say, be more proud of the things you say no to than the things that you say yes to.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think I'm sure I stole that from about 100,000
yeah,
people.
I don't know
that
where I heard
said
it first.
That. Yeah. But thank you for giving me that credit. But like, I mean, a lot of people, and it's true, like Warren Buffett says that. He's like, I see, look, this is a great example right now. In the time that we're in, Warren Buffett is sitting on a war chest of $200+ billion. It's a great example of decision-making. $200+ billion, probably even more than that right now. And he hasn't purchased any type of business, right, for the last 24 months. And people are like, did he lose his ability to do this? And he goes, it's not like he hasn't been presented with opportunities. I mean, he's Warren Buffett. I bet he's got 100 different opportunities every 15 seconds. And his thing was, he goes, there hasn't been the right opportunity. That's literally what he said. 2 years, $200 billion in cash, he could easily deploy. I mean, think about that for a second. Yet he hasn't bought anything for 24 months. I just find that so fascinating, his ability to hold, because he knows what's most important. He knows if he can't go into it and get the 20% return that he wants in this, he'll say no to it. Mm-hmm. He's very clear on what and when he'll invest. And I just think that's such a staple that we can take away from, a principle that we can have in our lives around making decisions in our lives. When you know what it is that you do or want or going after or allocating your time to, the decisions become easy. They just do. They just become easy once you're clear on this, right?
This could be a topic for another day, but I'm going to ask it. And how do you figure out what it is you want?
How do you figure...
If that's where you have to start, how do you figure that out?
A great place to start, and maybe this will be your takeaway that people can start with this, start writing what you don't want. Sometimes in order to figure out what it is that you do want, you need to start figuring out what it is that you don't want. So I would encourage everybody to sit down after you listen to this, find some quiet time for even 15 minutes, and just start writing down things that you don't want. And then that makes very... And then when all of a sudden something shows up in your life that's in your don't want category, it's very easy to say no. And then literally saying no also is a habit that you can form, and it just becomes part of your process, right? In the beginning, I remember seeing one of my mentors who's very successful. We used to work out together every day for about 7 or 8 years. I mean, very, very successful. And people would always come up to him and want his time, and they wanted his money, right? Like not, and they weren't mean. I would be with him in these social situations, working out for an hour and a half every day. And they would walk, and I just remember this. They would walk up to him and they'd be like, hey man, do you think you'd come to this fundraiser over here? And he goes, no, I can't do it. And at first I kept hearing it. I was like, man, that was rude. I was like, man, that was kind of like really stark. And it was just, it caught me off guard, right? Because he's a nice guy. And like, oh, you know, hey, what about this fundraiser? He goes, no, we've already allocated our funds for the year. And he just, and then so finally I asked him, I said, dude, like, you know, it sounded kind of like rough. He goes, I didn't mean it to be. And he goes, if I'm not clear on where I'm spending my time or my money, then I'll just start saying yes to everything. And I can't. And so I don't want to say maybe, or I don't want to give the impression that I may do this, knowing damn well that I don't have nothing, that I want nothing to do with this. So I guess it comes out that way because I want to be very clear to people that it's a no from me. And I just thought that was such a powerful takeaway in my life, is that to say no with authority. That's not being mean. It's you're taking direction and control of your life. And again, one other thing that somebody mentioned to me early on was nobody has the right to dumb your life up. One of the first conversations that I had was somebody sat down with me and said, look, Adam, understand, nobody has the right to dumb your life up. And he wasn't meaning it like somebody attacks you or different things. He was basically meaning is nobody has the right to take your time. Nobody has the right to take your time.
Or money,
right? That you don't want to, right? So just being very clear on that. I just thought that was a really cool.
I think that people, and at least I do, respect those individuals who have that conviction and about what they do with their life.
Yes, they do. And it's because they know that what you're doing is hard. Mm-hmm. It's not like they walk every day and after you say no to them, they're like, man, I really respect you for saying no to me because that was really awesome. They inherently kind of walk away going,
I wish I could do that,
right? They're like, oh, I wish I had the ability just to say no to that. And it's not to make you feel insignificant. It's that then you should take that and go, you know, and listen to our, you know, episode 14, right? That talks about how you gain clarity on these different things in yourself.
Thanks for listening to Business Meets Spirituality. If this episode resonated with you, check out adamhergenrother.com. That's HergenrotHer for more free resources and materials. And folks, remember, never give up on joy.